This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Linda Howe is with us on Dreamland today. It's going to be a really cool show. Linda and I go down some strange paths together, and we went down a ultra-high strangeness one in the past few weeks. You'll hear all about it, but right now, I'm talking to Mia Sarah Leno, who is going to be telling us about a conference in South Dakota that I am going to be attending that has to be one of the most unique and fascinating conferences that has ever been put together. Terrific guests, including me, and there's going to be a lot of Native American stuff there because it's taking place on a reservation. And as you know, the Native American component with regard to the whole close encounter experience is very deep, ancient, and profound. It's going to be really fascinating. So, Mia, welcome to Dreamland.
Oh, thank you, Whitley. Thank you for having me on your show. I really appreciate it.
Well, tell us about, I know I'm going to be sleeping in a teepee, and that's good, but tell us about the conference.
The conference is July 18th through the 22nd at the All Nations Gathering Center in Kyle, South Dakota, on the Pine Ridge Reservation. The Pine Ridge Reservation is the home of the Lakota Sioux tribe, and it geographically encompasses the Badlands National Park. So people will have opportunity to go out at night. We'll be going out at night in a group to meditate and make contact within the Badlands, which is one of the most extraordinary and powerful sites in our country, if not on the planet. The rock formations are you know, millions of years old. And because of the recent flooding on Pine Ridge in March and in this whole area, the colors are so extraordinary right now. All of the striations of the pinks and the magentas are visible in the rock formations, and the grass and the sky are just so intense. The, you know, the greens and the blues. It's just the most amazing time to come here.
Well, that's exciting. And tell us a little bit about what kind the Indians, the Native Americans, are putting on a program. Is that correct?
Well, a number of members of the Lakota tribe will be participating in our event. We're also including a scientific component. The Dark Matter Underground Research Facility is located in the Black Hills, which is considered to be the most sacred spot for Native Americans. And they are sending a speaker to discuss what they're doing at their underground base, which is a mile beneath the surface of the earth. They're working to locate and identify dark matter. CERN is involved in creating it, but right here in South Dakota, there's another facility which is pretty comparable to CERN in many ways. We'll be going to the Wounded Knee Memorial to see where, over 100 years ago, the U.S. Cavalry killed over 300 people of the Lakota tribe, and they're buried there in a mass grave. It's also the site of where in the early 1970s, the American Indian Movement was formed, and a siege took place there in the little town of Wounded Knee to demand the right for the Lakota tribe and all Native Americans to perform their sacred ceremonies, such as the Sun Dance, which had been illegal up until that point. So we'll be doing that. We'll actually be attending a Sun Dance ceremony. And Dallas Chief Eagle, who is a sacred hoop dancer and has traveled all around the world performing, including dancing for the Dalai Lama, will be performing a hoop dance for us our first night there and sharing the Lakota creation story with us, which, of course, includes sky beings, star beings.
Well, this sounds really exciting. And also, folks, it's going to be a fairly intimate conference. It's not one of these gigantic 5,000 people conferences at all. It's much more intimate. So there'll be a lot closer contact between guests and speakers, for example. Why don't you tell us a little bit about the speakers? Besides me, we all know about me already.
Well, we're delighted to have you as one of our main speakers. And in fact, this conference grew out of my own spiritual journey and combines Lakota spirituality, ET exploration, but also your own work in terms of communicating with our loved ones who've passed on has been part of my development as well, and dealing with other kingdoms as well, the animal kingdom. You mentioned Linda Moulton Howe, and last year's conference in Vermont, our first speaker was an animal communicator, David Lewis, and the Lakota. Linda had shared a very moving story about her cat at the Simba at the time, but the Lakota have deep respect for the winged and the four-legged. So all of these dimensions and kingdoms, in fact, are interconnected. When we're communicating with the divine, we're communicating on all levels, and that's really what this conference is about, to open people up to the land, the sacred land, and each other in a very meaningful way. Our speakers include Ananda Bosman, who developed 432 Hertz frequency. He'll be talking about his music and the opening up of our bodies through the notes, but also he'll be leading us out in the Badlands National Park as we make contact. He has a lot of experience doing that in Europe. Alan Steinfeld of New Realities will be talking about hybrid DNA and the recent research he's been doing on that subject. Art therapist Suzanne Bishop will be talking about hybrid children and hybrid people and the work of Barbara Lamb and Mary Rodwell and her own experience in the Pittsburgh area working with clients. Terry Lovelace will be talking about his abduction experience when he was 19 years old. He's the former Assistant Attorney General of the state of Vermont and published a book on his ET experience a year ago and recently spoke at Contact in the Desert. Kevin Briggs will be channeling and answering questions about his own experience as a contactee since childhood. I think he was 8 years old when he first was contacted. Cindy Ketches will be talking about Lakota spirituality. Her husband Peter Ketches and her father-in-law Pete Ketches were both very well-respected medicine men on the Pine Ridge Reservation. As I mentioned, we have a speaker from the Dark Matter Underground Research Facility, and Yvonne Smith will be talking about abductees and the work that she's done with Bud Hopkins and John Mack.
Yeah, so we have Yvonne, of course, a good friend of this website and of me.
She's an amazing, amazing woman. I'm really looking forward to hearing everything that she has to share. So it's quite a group, as well as this extraordinary group of attendees who are coming together. As you mentioned, it's a small group. We'll have no more than 25 attendees and 10 speakers. So everyone will be interacting with each other in a very intimate way.
Sounds like the staffing of a very high-end cruise ship.
Yeah. Yes, exactly.
So it's going to be a very intimate gathering, folks, is what we're saying.
And you know, have lots of space for sharing of personal experiences. And my feeling about this group is that we're coming together for a particular reason at this moment in time. We have several attorneys, several therapists. I think that we have the opportunity to network and create a group where we're actively being activists for the disclosure movement. And those of us who've had these experiences, by sharing and talking about them, not only among ourselves, but with others, we're really pushing disclosure forward in a meaningful way. And in my opinion, that's what needs to happen right now. We need to find our spiritual center as a world and change the way things have been going.
That's very well said. And, you know, folks, as this disclosure process continues, inevitably the visitors are going to get closer to us. That's what my life work and the life work of many people in this community has always been all about. So join us if you would like to. How would they go about doing that?
My email address is Mia, M-I-A dot Feroletto, F as in Frank, E-R-O-L-E-T-O at gmail.com. And I can also be reached by phone at 802-952-6217.
That's 802-952-6217. Mia, thank you so much for being with us. And I'm looking forward to life in my teepee and out there in the Black Hills. I'm really looking forward to it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Whitley. See you soon.
See you soon. Back a few weeks ago at Contact in the Desert, the big mama of all UFO conferences in the United States, Linda Moulton Howe and I had what could be safely described as a spectacularly high strangeness experience. We're going to be talking about that experience for the next hour, and then after that, subscribers are going to get an interesting first experience. I will be reading for the first time from my new book, A New World, about contact with the visitors, how it works, and how I have lived it for the past 30 years. So get set for that. And if you're not an unknowncountry.com subscriber, now really is the time, because the times, they are a-changing, and this is stuff we all are going to need to know and to learn how to live with, because believe me, nobody's going to tell us, no government officials, no UFO investigators, nobody. The only people who are going to be able to talk about how to live with the visitors are the people who are doing that, and not the liars, but the real deal. And this is one of them talking to you right now. One reporter who loves mysteries is radio's leading science journalist, Linda Moulton Howe. She's an Emmy Award-winning TV producer, documentary filmmaker, and the reporter and editor for EarthFiles.com, the internet's most respected edge science website. Today, we're going to be talking about something pretty unusual that happened to us both at Contact in the Desert the weekend of May the 31st. This is a very unusual show. Starting on Sunday, something strange began happening to me that culminated quite dramatically at Linda's intensive, and we will hear from Linda in just a moment about what the intensive was, and we can explore why this may have happened, because it's really a very strange business. It started in the hotel lobby on Sunday afternoon for me, I was walking through the lobby and suddenly felt as if the air pressure around me had dropped and my ears began popping. I turned to the person beside me with whom I was walking and said, "Do you notice anything?" He said, "No." And I felt a sense of being kind of in a bubble, and it was really odd. I thought, maybe I'm coming down with a cold. And soon it passed, and I forgot about it. At 3 o'clock that morning, after my meditation, I had a similar experience while in bed. And there was a popping in my ears, and suddenly I was plunged into what seemed like another world with what looked like traffic racing past in front of me as if I was standing on the edge of a highway. It was really shocking. It was not a dream in any normal sense of the word. If anything, you could say maybe it was some sort of a seizure, but I'm healthy and I don't have seizures. It felt like bilocation, to be quite honest. Then comes Monday morning and Linda's intensive. I try never to miss Linda's performances at these conferences, because talk about worth going to. They are really, really good. And so I was sitting in the intensive, and it happened again. But this time, it was as if people were sitting on both sides of me that weren't there. In other words, they were there and not there at the same time. I could feel their presence and even see them, but they weren't there. I have the feeling that she was saying things they didn't want her to say. That was my feeling. And the sense of lowered air pressure and so forth occurred again during this. And I went through listening to her as best I could while this was going on. And then at the end of the presentation, one of the people a couple of rows ahead of me leaped up and shouted that I had been talking during her presentation, during the end of her presentation, and it had prevented this woman from hearing Linda's, as she put it, Linda's last words. And what was so bizarre about this is I was entirely silent. As far as I could tell, I wasn't saying a word. So that's what happened to me. And now I would like to welcome Linda Moulton Howe back to this show for the umpteenth time to discuss just exactly what you were doing and what the intensive was about, so that we can explore what may have attracted this other presence, because that's what it was. It was another presence coming through me somehow, simply because I'm so sensitive to this stuff, I guess. So welcome to Dreamland, Linda.
Well, thank you, Whitley. I know that in the last third, it was a full 3-hour workshop presentation. It was entirely scripted. It had hundreds of images, audio. It is one of those presentations that I consider a kind of major work for a conference. I've done it in England, and it, at the heart of it, the issue is binary codes, zeros and ones, that have gone into the minds, or however you want to say it, telepathically, of people who have served in the military, as well as abductees, and sources that I have had now over the last 40 years with pieces of information all related to alien presences, our government's knowledge about them, confusion about them, the whole issue of binary code that would be coming into one of the military ear witness, mind witness, warning that there are hostiles and that there are friendlies, and that the friendlies have been trying to protect evolving humankind, but there are hostiles who would like to eradicate life on this planet for reasons that are not known or explained. But not only in a sergeant who is currently still in the Army, but Staff Sergeant Jim Peniston, who was at the Rendlesham event with John Burroughs and Ed Kovansak at the end of December 1980, and other abductees. They have been people who have written down zeros and ones. And in this 3 hours of solidly vetted, researched, and very detailed translations in terms of audio that I use from these people themselves about what it is they have experienced, about in the last third, so in the last hour, because it was 3 full hours of nonstop production from my computer and from me to the end. In the last hour, at one point, what came through my mind, which was extremely active, my mind was actively engaged in doing the script and keeping the images and everything going, came this thought, almost like a thought voice, but more like a silent thought. There is one or more alien intelligences in this room. And I don't think I've ever remembered having anything that specific ever come through my mind's eye.
Now, well, I can assure you it was true. Go ahead.
It's odd that that happened. But what I cannot understand, this 3-hour presentation that I have given around the world, literally, and started working on 3 years ago. It has been in presentations in pieces and then the whole 3 hours about 3 or 4 times. There is no one in the military, no one in the government, no one in science who has ever come to me with anything critical. All I have gotten is, Linda, you're right on the right track. Keep going. Keep developing this information about binary code, that it is one of the keys to an alien communication with some minds, some human minds on this planet. Our government began to recognize this long before Bentwaters. It just happens that Staff Sergeant Jim Peniston in the forest said that when there was a blast of white light that he and John Burroughs both saw, and then Burroughs either disappeared, was abducted. It's hard to tell because John does not remember anything. But Jim Peniston remembers the flash of light and the sudden emergence of a black, glassy surface of triangular-shaped craft that was warm to the touch in comparison to the cold, humid Rendlesham forest on December 26th after 1 o'clock in the morning, and that he dragged his hands around on the glassy surface, seeing lights moving inside of it, realizing that it was warmer than the cold forest. And when he got around to the other side, up to one of the three vertices that would be pointing sort of away from where he was walking, when he got to the front of that triangular structure, his hands that had been dragging along on the glassy surface, he suddenly realized in the dark that his fingers were hitting something that reminded him of Braille. And as his fingers touched these raised symbols on this glassy triangle, he says instantly into his mind came zeros and ones and hieroglyphs and symbols, and he was disoriented about what was happening. But that after, I'm going to jump now from that event into the morning after the sun came up and he and John and Ed Kovansak were finally taken to where they lived, Peniston said he didn't know whether he should go to a doctor or what, but he couldn't get the zeros and ones to stop moving from the right side of his mind's eye to the left side, going on a quite brisk pattern. And that it was getting to a point where he felt like he wanted to scream. He wanted to do something that would stop the zeros and ones. And then a voice, a thought voice, came into his mind that said, sit down, write the numbers in your notebook, then the numbers will stop. That's basically what he remembered in his mind. He always carried a 7 by 9 inch notebook. And when he filled them up, he filed them because he attended a lot of airplane crashes, and he always wanted to have a notebook because there were always emergencies in the military. He sat down with that notebook. Instead of going to the front, which carried all of his notes, he says, about what was happening out in the forest, they were in the front of his notebook, he went to the back. And in the last approximately 10 pages of the notebook, he started writing with an ink pen, zeros and ones that filled up, if I'm recalling correctly, something like 8.5 pages. Maybe it was 7. But all of this is all documented at myearthfiles.com. And in so many places now, you can see the pages photographed in his notebook that are at Earth Files. Okay, so now, as soon as he had written down those zeros and ones, exactly as the voice had promised, he finally could be normal. The moving zeros and ones went away. The tension, the horrible tension, a headache he was getting, it all went away. And he said, when he first showed John Burroughs and me and a producer for Ancient Aliens the back of his notebook, it was in October of 2010. And what was happening? We were doing an Ancient Aliens in production in Phoenix, where John worked and lived at the time. And the idea was that we were going in depth into as much as possible before we all left as a group in December to go for the 30th anniversary of the 1980 December. And we were going to England with the Ancient Aliens, executive producer, director, crew, everyone, and that we would be going into the forest to truly experiment with these two guys, being first time back together in England since December of 1980. That was our trip. And that, what would they feel? What would they see? And a lot of remarkable things happened. Now, this is one of several big segments in my presentation having to do with the mystery of binary code telepathic downloads in military minds who have encountered UFOs, as well as abductees, and then people that I have met in the government, whether in Washington, D.C., or in other bases, who have over 40 years now have communicated to me information that relates to everything I've just been saying. And therefore, I think that the 3 hours that I was presenting in that workshop at Contact in the Desert on what was June 3rd, and so it would seem to me that if there were one or more alien intelligences somehow in that room, disguised, camouflaged as a human, or they were invisible in the room, this would be because the information may be something, as you just pointed out, that they might not want me to present. Beyond the Army Sergeant, beyond Staff Sergeant Jim Peniston and Rendlesham, there was another Army Sergeant in the modern time of 2017, that period. He had continuous binary code coming into his head from beings that he described as tall, thin, gray, and they look like, if you go on the web, immersers, a new word in the categories of alien intelligences, But what is significant is that I kept translating with the help of a Navy captain and a scientist, the zeros and ones from that Army sergeant and who had an experience now, not in 1980, but in the 2016-2017 time period. And one of the zeros and ones translated through the University of Pennsylvania included both Akkadian and Sumerian words, and that when the translation was sent to me by the professor of Sumerian and Akkadian instruction at the University of Pennsylvania, it basically said the Lord Nabu, N-A-B-U, is returning in a chariot to earth. And earth was the last word, K-I, Sumerian for earth. That was such a fascinating translation. The Army sergeant knew zero about anything having to do with Sumeria or Anunnaki or Akkadian or Assyrian, knew zero. I asked, and he was literally, Linda, I don't know anything about this. And what impressed me is that if you go back to 1980 and Jim Peniston in the forest in Rendlesham, you're getting downloads about there is urgency. Humanity must advance. More knowledge must be shared if humans are going to survive. That was December 1980, Jim Peniston. Jump to the sergeant that I was featuring as part of my work having to do with binary codes at contact. This modern day sergeant, his binary code was constantly, it was repeating, humans must advance faster. We who are allies are trying to help you, but there are hostiles who are out there, and if they come and humans have not advanced fast enough, it could be the end of humanity. It's like bookends from 1980 to the 2016, 2017, 2018 time period. And today, as we are moving toward the new decade of 2020, all over, there are all kinds of symbols and signals that are coming from people in the human abduction syndrome.
Yes, that's for sure.
They are saying, if humanity does not get the truth, if we do not have governments that finally own up to the fact that since World War II, at least, they have had all kinds of information about alien presences, that they have been working on back engineering of alien technologies, keeping it all away from the current human population, there may be an existential point coming where events are going to be such a shock, or physically, geophysically, overtaking the Earth in such a huge way that humans will literally be swamped physically, swamped mentally, swamped spiritually, and that will kill us as much as a physical assault. That is coming through abductees right now. That is exactly what was in the binary code spanning from the 1980 to the current time. And so I take it very seriously that what I was presenting in those 3 hours of that intensive workshop at Contact were very valuable words that were coming from many directions. And that the government people who have been whistleblowers to me now since at least 1983, they have the same message. They are frustrated. They are frustrated by too much compartmentalization. They are frustrated by the fact that they have knowledge that things coming could be dangerous and that all humans deserve the right to know what their government. No. And that, Whitley, that is the bottom line of my 3-hour presentation. And if there were any alien intelligences camouflaged or disguised there, who were communicating to you derision, well, a pox on their house, because all humans that I care about need to know what I was presenting on June 3rd, 2019.
And what was there, that presence, as scary as it was, has had the effect of emphasizing the importance of your presentation. which was somehow or another behind it. I've been living with this thing for a long time now on a very direct basis, and that's kind of how it works. I'll give you an example. After Annie passed away, there was an immediate increase in my whole involvement with this, to the point where I could no longer tell whether I was involved with a non-human presence or the human dead or Annie or a kind of mixture of them. And there became in 2016 the forming of a book, and I tried to write it any number of times, and finally last February I had a direct contact basically saying, if you do not do this and get this finished right now, your soul is in trouble. And they showed me just what that meant. And boy, I am telling you, the book is now finished. It's in proofreading. It will be published as soon as possible, because you are quite right. This whole thing is coming up against some kind of a wall. We're running out of time. I wouldn't be surprised if there aren't major changes of some sort in or around 2020, because it's that close. And after all, look at the stuff that is coming out through to the stars and all of that, and you don't know what where those people are coming from. Because one of the things that's always been an issue is the government's desire to continue to control this even after it is public knowledge. And how do you do that? You do that by terrifying people and saying, we and we alone can protect you. Then they cluster to you and everything stays as it should. But that may not be, A, two things. It may not be true that it's dangerous, at least at the level that it's going to first contact us. And two, it may be that the government can't do anything anyway, even if it is dangerous. I'm going to be attending two conferences over the next few months. The first is Consciousness and Contact at the Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota, July 18th to the 22nd. I'm going to be there with Yvonne Smith, Alan Steinfeld, Ananda Bosman, Kevin Briggs, and others. It's a small conference, but it is a very interesting one. It's going to include a traditional Lakota feast. I'm going to be talking about ascension and the afterlife based around my book, The Afterlife Revolution. There's going to be a breakfast and a trip to the Wounded Knee Memorial. There will also be a Sundance. Other speakers will be Cindy Ketches, who will provide an overview of Lakota spirituality, Alan Steinfeld, his research on hybrids, remote viewing, developing multidimensional consciousness. Ananda Bosman will be discussing the 432 healing frequency and what it all means. Yvonne Smith will be talking about abductees. There's going to be a lot going on there. If you want to go, call Mia Ferroleto at 802-952-6217 or email her at mia.ferroleto@gmail.com. That's 802-952-6217 for Consciousness and Contact, July 18 to 22 in the Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota. Then, on October 4th through the 6th, I'm going to be at the Portal to Ascension Conference in Long Beach, California, and along with a very large number of other guests. It's a big conference. Billy Jackson, JJ and Desiree Hertak, Barbara Lamb, Jason Quitt will be there, Alan Steinfeld again, John D'Souza, Michael Tellinger, Ray Hernandez will be there, Travis Walton will be there. As I say, it's a big conference, October 4th to the 6th at the Atrium Hotel in Irvine, California. Find out more at ascensionconference.com.
Earthfiles.com is Linda Moulton Howe's great website, offering news of the edge of science and reality. Keep up with Linda's work every single day on earthfiles.com. The new unknown country is here, and it has so much to offer. Our huge archive of Dreamland, plus the full run of William Henry's revelations, Anne Strieber's mysterious powers and her incredible contactee interviews, Whitley's Communion, Secret School, Transformation, and Majestic ebooks, his powerful meditations, and so much more. Plus every week, the full subscriber versions of Whitley's Dreamland, Mike Clellan's The Unseen, and monthly, Jeremy Vaney's The Experience. We offer subscriptions either by credit card or PayPal, either automatic renewal or annual or longer subscriptions without auto-renew. Plus, it's easy to cancel if you wish. Do it right in your account. Plus, a live chat every week on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. Pacific, and so much more. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and subscribe. Keep this incredible site going and have a great time doing it.
There are hundreds of charitable organizations in the world, but you have to have a sharp eye to be sure your money is going to where it's needed and not into the pockets of overpaid administrators. That's why Whitley Strieber and UnknownCountry.com support the Mercy Corps. It's non-sectarian, it's lean and efficient, and it goes everywhere on earth that people are in need. When you contribute, you can be sure that most of your dollar goes right to the homeless, the starving, and the desperate. Go to Unknown Country and click on the Mercy Corps Foundation ad on the left side of your homepage. A $10 gift can put food on a child's plate and shoes on his feet. Unknown Country and Whitley Strieber receive no compensation from the Mercy Corps.
Whitley, that's where I always part company with the, we'll call them the government controllers, because I really do look at humanity as deserving equal knowledge to their so-called power brokers and leaders.
Of course.
And that if they know that something is coming that could wipe out a great deal of human population if we're not prepared, and they are operating under policies, we will go to the last collective breath and then tough. Then in the big, huge arena of the divine field in relationship to matter world, I would not want to trade places with any of those power brokers, with any of those military or so-called government leaders, because that is basically saying the only thing we care about are ourselves, and we are going to make sure that we have a back door on Mars and the moon and out in interstellar trade, because we know that humanity is going to take it. They're going to be killed. And we will survive. That is underlying. And the people who are now in government, who know everything that I presented in those 3 hours plus more, how do you live with yourself? If you are, let's assume that they are Homo sapiens sapien of some type, a lot of them may be hybrids, a lot of them may be full-blood ETs hiding or camouflaged as humans. I think that is possible, but how can we go into the middle of this 21st century with a policy that whatever is coming, another flood, a fire event, an asteroid, hostile ETs, whatever it is, and not giving our fellow human beings the respect and chance to at least know before there was some catastrophic event? I cannot I just cannot go into that headspace because I could never do that to my fellow humans.
You know what the visitors I work with call the secrecy? They call it an addiction.
Huh.
An addiction. They say they are addicted to it.
Wow.
And I find that fascinating because, of course, it must be thrilling to know the secrets and walk the streets and know that you are above and beyond all of these little people around you, and they don't even know it. It's an ego trip in a sense.
Yeah.
But also the other side of the coin is there's a lot of dark stuff that they don't understand and can't control and are afraid to reveal, because then that does reveal the truth, which is that they're helpless. I know that. I know they are pretty much entirely helpless when it comes to this, because I know something. They're very interested in my implant, and I know something, not because I've been given any classified information whatsoever. I have not. But because of questions I've been asked suggest that they really are pretty helpless. Well, it was a remarkable experience. And the fact that you felt that presence, which was literally right with me, right around me, was interesting. And it's too bad that I didn't get a chance to talk to that lady because she rushed out furious. I wish I could know what words she had heard said. Free Dreamlanders, we'll be right back.
Whitley Strieber became the host of Dreamland in 1998, and he's still the host today. One of the first podcasts, Dreamland has been built into the premier program of its kind, exploring the edge of science and reality. The show's archive on unknowncountry.com dates back to 2004. Dreamland is a treasure unique in the world.
At this point in this commercial, I used to say that you can't subscribe because we are still in our old website, but that has changed at last. UnknownCountry.com's new website is available. Go to UnknownCountry.com and take a look. It is beautiful. It offers a huge archive, weekly chats, a free message board, all kinds of great stuff. Whitley Strieber audiobooks for subscribers, and much, much more. New stuff coming on the site all the time. So go to unknowncountry.com, take a look, and really open your mind. How do you do that? By subscribing and exploring and having a great time.
There are hundreds of charitable organizations in the world, but you have to have a sharp eye to be sure your money is going to where it's needed, and not into the pockets of overpaid administrators. That's why Whitley Strieber and UnknownCountry.com support the Mercy Corps. It's non-sectarian, it's lean and efficient, and it goes everywhere on earth that people are in need. When you contribute, you can be sure that most of your dollar goes right to the homeless, the starving, and the desperate. Go to Unknown Country and click on the Mercy Corps Foundation ad on the left side of your homepage. A $10 gift can put food on a child's plate and shoes on his feet. Unknown Country and Whitley Strieber receive no compensation from the Mercy Corps.
In any case, I don't think I was talking at all. In fact, I didn't hear anybody around me talking either.
If you were not talking in
not at
a
all.
Verbal frequency sense, then what did she hear from, let's say, an alien presence
Yes.
that was, in fact, trying to manipulate one or more human minds in my three-hour workshop?
Right.
And that is, to me, this is why being able to talk about everything publicly is healthy, because whatever happened in that room, now I'm educated about what happened, and otherwise I would not have known outside of that thought that went through my mind. And the governments who feel, oh, well, we can't have the stock market collapse, we can't have any questions about religion. That is exactly what needs to be done. That is exactly what they have to go through, so that the whole planet goes through it together at the same time. That is the only fair option.
Well, of course it is. And the other thing is that if the broader world of science and humanity and the academic world, all of that, knew this and could and understood that it was real, people would focus on it in a different way. And this is, never think that aliens are somewhere far beyond us. This species is really smart and really capable. But that's why we're kept in ignorance, I think. I think that if we weren't ignorant, we would very quickly find all kinds of extraordinary and innovative ways that you and I can't even imagine right now to get our hands around this situation.
And to say, all right, governments of the world, power brokers, announce it, and then you will see how strong humans can be when they are included, and how resourceful, and that if there are allies, if there are true friendlies that are not trying to harvest from us and that's all they want, if they really have our best interests at heart, they would help us get through that breakthrough. And they would know that on the other side of whatever turmoil we go through in finally being told the truth, that on the other side are hostiles that can take advantage of us now as they have for centuries and would continue to if we are continually left in the dark and we are always told the lies. That's the revolutionary breaking point now. Are we going to turn ourselves into a planet of humans that are led by people who actually care about humans? And that we're going to switch to a planet that is not concocted, but is going to be educated, I hope, with alien help that is truly positive and constructive. I would think they're waiting in the wings. What is the block? Why are we at this exact chaotic moment right now as we are about to head to 2020? And if that physicist that I have mentioned before, I have talked about in some of my presentations, I swear that man has told me the truth about his work underground at Area 51 and that they knew then that there were cycles of burps from the black holes at the center of galaxies in this universe. And it is not the release of light. It is not the release of matter. It is totally consistent with physical laws. But there are now in 2019, for the very first time, new physics papers. They are referring to it as a burp from the black hole. Remember, I heard this from the physicist 7-8 years ago. The burp from the black hole that is now being described. They're not saying in the papers what the physicist told me. He said, when the black hole at the center of the Milky Way galaxy does its next burp, it's an energy burp. It has something to do with formulas and how they figure how much matter and light can be sucked into a black hole of a certain diameter, and then there will be a release of energy in a burp. And when this happens, this man in the 1970s was being briefed about this, that the Noah's flood was a real event, and things like Noah's flood would happen because if you are on a sphere that is rotating at 33,000, 35,000 miles an hour as the Earth is, and you are 8,000 miles in diameter, 25,000 miles around, and you are rotating and revolving around the sun, and then comes this burp of energy from the black hole at the center of the Milky Way galaxy. The way the physicist told me a few years ago was there will be a jerk. That was his word. There will be a jerk of the Earth. There will be a jerk of the planetary bodies. What happens on a planet that is two-thirds deep water if there is a momentary jerk? Water has to catch up with the matter. And that is what would cause, as that physicist said, there could be 1,000-foot-high tsunamis along the entire western coast of North America.
And there is evidence all over this planet that such things have happened before. It could be that that's quite true and that this could happen.
Whatever the truth is, the Russia China and the United States know, if they know, and they are choosing since World War II, as they evolve with knowledge and their interactions with non-humans, which they have done without question, and they made a choice. We can't save everybody, therefore we will continue to the last breath, and everybody will just live their lives, and nobody will ever know.
Except when the wall of water hits them.
Well, I personally think, see, if that's the planning of the last 70 years, which is no announcement, in the big scheme of a divine field's relationship to matter worlds, for a tiny number of people to make that kind of decision that would affect billions, it is so out of whack with what is morally right that there has to be some kind of retribution at the soul level or something. I would not want to be these people.
Free Dreamlanders, we'll be right back.
They are found deep in a dying jungle, 6 infants. They aren't apes. They aren't human either, not quite. So, what are they? When they are spirited off to the United States, an incredible discovery is made. They are as smart as us, but not us, not human. The company that found them wants to buy and sell them as the most valuable animals on Earth, brilliant workers who need not be paid. Somebody has to stop this travesty, and that's where primatologist Beth Cook comes in. But can she stand up to the power and wealth that seeks to exploit them? Find out in Whitley Strieber's first standalone science fiction novel in 7 years. New. Get it on Amazon as an ebook or paperback.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. For music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
You know, Linda, I think that's all that this is about in the end. It's about souls.
This is what we should be teaching our planet.
Right.
If we did, if people knew there really was cause and effect, consequences to what you do, that maybe rape would go down, murder would go down, war would go down, and that this planet might start growing up into some kind of resonance with life.
You know, I think there's somebody who wants bad souls, who actually uses them in some way, who harvests them.
If this planet had been taught over the last 5,000 years by power brokers and leaders who gave a tinker's damn about what was going to happen to humanity, we would have been taught cause and effect. We would have been taught cause and effect on everything, that today we would not have tons of plastic killing the oceans. We would not be in this spiral of our own civilization producing a warming trend that could take off, and we really will be in trouble. We would have been taught how to conserve. We would have been taught not to waste. We would not have been taught the Kardashian world. And this is, to me, this is where the rubber hits the road.
Right. Well, instead, we were taught eat more hamburgers and burn more oil.
And the biggest, what is it right now, the number of people who are over 60 who have diabetes? And they have diabetes because they are overweight and they do nothing but eat sugar in life.
And look at the TV. When you see the ads for these gigantic, fat-filled hamburgers and soft drinks, sugar. It's horrifying. This is deadly. It's like selling heart attacks and diabetes.
Yeah.
Free Dreamlanders, we'll be right back. You think that what subscribers to unknowncountry.com get is just an archive or a rehash of what you can hear for free? Not quite true. Listen to this.
The Indonesian doctor is writing an article in the 1980s. This is more than 10 years after the mysterious German doctor has died. And now he's writing his recollections of that whole episode. And one of his recollections was that there was a small boy at one time when he first met the doctor in the island of Sumbawa. There was a small American boy living with him.
And that small American boy may very well have been the son of the mysterious doctor that Peter Lavenda is talking about. A special interview called Adolf Hitler in Asia. That boy went on to grow up, to come to the United States, to become a horrendous anti-Semite and serial killer. He was executed in Indiana in 2010. I'm telling you, you don't hear this anywhere else. Nowhere else. So come on, get on the stick. Become a subscriber to unknowncountry.com. I guarantee you there is incredible information in our subscriber area, and we need you to keep supporting this. It's important. There's no place like it. No other website offers you the amazing riches of unusual and extraordinary information that we do. Subscribe today. Linda, what's going on here?
I don't think humanity has been played fair with, and we still are not being, because we're still living this lie that now a few people are trying to open up through Navy pilots and shreds of leaked documents. And why? Why overnight couldn't this planet just simply be told all of the truth?
Linda, I tried and tried to get the visitors to do that, to just spend 5 minutes on television or 3 minutes or something like that. And then this whole community, all the close encounter witnesses, everybody like you, will come forward with the message that's there, that's been in our lives for years and years. And the result is, after a considerable amount of difficulty, the writing of this book. And maybe it will help. I hope it helps.
What is your title?
A New World.
A New World, which is like Corso. A new
exactly.
world is it, coming it, if you can take it.
And in the third segment of the show, I'm going to be reading it for subscribers, reading the first half hour of the introduction. I'll keep doing that over the next few months, even though it is in manuscript form. I want it to get out as quickly as possible, and my subscribers are going to be the first to know. It is based on Corso's comment, A New World, If You Can Take It. As soon as I heard Phil say that, I was sitting, I talked with Phil for hours at the 50th anniversary of the
Rock. Yeah, we were all there.
You were there, that's right. You sat, and you heard
and,
it.
And he and I had a private meeting for about 3 hours after I think it was 2 or 3 hours that we did with Art Bell
yes.
on Coast to Coast.
Well, you know, it's interesting that you had a private meeting with him, too, because so did I. He was, and I also had indirect contact. Members of my family knew Strom Thurmond quite well, and I got back to Thurmond about this, who was, by the way, absolutely furious at Phil, because he didn't know a thing about UFOs, nothing. And he had suddenly was getting all these letters and all this stuff about this book that he didn't even, I mean, he knew Phil, and he did confirm that Phil was indeed the intelligence officer he said he was. That he did confirm.
Right.
But in any case, when I heard Phil say those words, and I suppose you must have been sitting right with me then.
Well, he and I did an interview. I don't think you were there where we were that. Because he had arranged with the book publisher that he wanted to talk with me. And in fact, it's interesting that when he was introduced by the book publisher to me, everything had been arranged because he requested a meeting with me. And then I asked him if we could do radio with Art Bell. So I'm now meeting.
And you did that extraordinary interview on Art Bell. I remember
exactly.
It very well.
And as the colonel is being introduced to me, he extended his hand. He looked at me with a twinkle in his eye, and he said, "I want to know how you got so much classified information," and said that as he was shaking my hand. And I know that in reading The Day After Roswell, how much I know about animal mutilations after 40 years, how much is correctly reported in the book, and that Colonel Corso was getting animal mutilation reports on his desk and in the Pentagon. And they had reports that went back, he said, to the 1951, I believe, in the Pentagon. And he was working in the 60s. So that means that he had files on animal mutilations, exactly as I began investigating in September of 79. That means that our government for almost a quarter of a century, going back from 79, they knew all about animal mutilations. They knew that there was a technology that was involved that they didn't understand, both in the excisions, the ability to remove hearts and other organs from inside bodies of animals that had no surgery on the outside. That was, as a laser researcher told me, one of our, and this was back in 79, he said, one of our hopes is that one day we will have molecular surgery on this planet. And that will mean you will be surgery will be by frequency only. You will know the frequency of the heart. You will have a scope. You will send a beam. The beam will go through the skin, the cartilage, the bone, other organs. It will only interact with the frequency, let's say, of the heart. You will be able to do a precise excision. You will be able to take tumors. You will be able to excise stones from gallbladders. He went through it, and it will all be molecular. On this planet now in 2019, we don't have any public knowledge of such molecular surgery.
Because it's concealed behind a wall of secrecy, and nothing is done with it because there's nobody back there with the capability of doing that. I think, you know, speaking of that, of molecular surgery, my implant was put in that way because there was absolutely no scar. Yeah. It was put in that way. It had to have been.
And we deserve to know what humans, if they are Homo sapiens sapiens leaders, if they are Homo sapiens sapiens bankers, if they are Homo sapiens sapiens power brokers, how can they keep the truth of both friendly, neutral, and hostile other intelligences from us endlessly, at least 70 years and counting? How can they do that and sleep and see their eyes and sleep at night? Because there is something that is cruel and abusive. And the idea that elitists going back to the Anunnaki and before have always misused, abused, manipulated DNA in already evolving primates to create their androids that could work on this planet, that evolved into Denisovans and Neanderthal and Cro-Magnon Homo sapiens sapiens, the latest model. And that we are now on a planet where the power brokers and the military leaders and those that are making all of the money barter system work, if they all know and they aren't telling 5 billion other people what they know, that perpetuates an abuse that is beyond my comprehension, because every human on this planet deserves the same knowledge as the so-called leaders who are already planning to leave the planet and go to Mars and go to someplace else when everything starts to fall apart.
Yeah. What is the richest man in the world spending his money on?
Elon Musk wants to go to Mars.
Well, so does Jeff Bezos, I believe.
Oh, yes, exactly.
Yeah. And they want to go to Mars because they think that there's no way you can survive here. But I also think that they are maybe even sort of programmed into a state of greed. Like, I often wonder when I see people with billions and billions of dollars, why they keep getting money when it is no longer relevant to them, and why they cling to it so, and to the point of wanting to keep the rest of us in a state of helpless ignorance in order to stay the way they are and keep things as they are. In this life, I almost sometimes think, do they already know that they have lost their souls, or they don't have them anymore? They left.
I don't think that they honor souls at all.
But they want, they're so obsessed with the material world, which is only a very transitory part of conscious experience, after all. So you just have to wonder. But we get into a situation where something is about to explode.
Yeah, I feel it. I do.
I do too. I really do. And I've felt it coming for a long time. And in the whole close encounter experience and the UFO experience, I mean, if you go back to the early contactees, half of them were predicting the end of the world was right around the corner. And that happens to you when you're in a close encounter situation. You begin to feel this sense of doom and very dark things about the future. But what you don't realize is they're not on the same timeline you are. You feel like it's going to happen next year when they're thinking about something that's much longer term, or they were.
Yeah.
I'm not so sure it's so long term anymore.
Yeah, but you're making a very good point about the various relativities of timelines. The more I have done investigations with people in human abduction syndrome and what whistleblowers, God bless the whistleblowers who are as frustrated and irritated as you and I by the fact that they have been exposed to time travel. They've been exposed to portals. They have been exposed that there are other dimensions. They've been exposed that there are other universes. And they have said to their bosses, why are we not telling the people of the earth? And the answer always is because the stock market would collapse, religions would be destroyed, and they have a list. And when you think of how large the disconnect is, how big the lie or lies are now, and there may be the current effort to focus on pilots, jet fighter pilots, especially the Navy, is that they think that if they can get out some credible people and credible stories about UFOs, that will be the Band-Aid, that will be the tape connector, meaning they're in one world that is so far beyond where the current surface life of Earth is that it's the disconnect is huge. We're in interstellar trade. I know for a fact of a person who has been out in outer space, interstellar travel for 3 years. Someday I hope to talk with him when he comes back. That is going. That is happening. We probably already have real estate on planet someplace else.
Meanwhile, well, that's very frustrating.
Meanwhile,
I have. If that's true, it's outrageous.
In exactly. And meanwhile, on planet Earth, what is coming in the next 20 years of global climate change alone? They're projecting on the computer already that there will be 200-mile-an-hour winds with tornadoes and hurricanes. There's nothing in the so-called surface world that is built to sustain 200-mile-an-hour. That isn't a gust. That's wind. And that's what the computers are showing are going to happen.
Well, it's happened in the past. This has happened in the past, according to papers I've recently read, scientific papers. One of them is actually called Superstorms. And yeah, it describes these storms as having sustained winds of in excess of 300 miles an hour, blowing up in the Atlantic thousands of years ago, and warns that the conditions are going to repeat. It's right out of my book, Superstorm. And that's why I'm sure that's why James Hansen and the 11 other writers of this paper decided to use the word superstorm in it, because they were trying to communicate that it's real.
And I remember I was doing all of that reporting with physicists and climatologists back in the early 90s. And you and Art were taking some of that information I was reporting, and that you collaborated together on that book, Superstorm.
Right.
And that it started with my interviews with real scientists and real news that today, in 2019, it is beginning to manifest around us. What has happened to the Midwest in 2019, the constant perpetual flooding, the inability, it's now, I believe, only 60-some percent of the land has been planted that would normally
be planted because of the flooding, that's right.
And the computers always showed in all of the models going all the way back to the early 90s when I was doing all of that reporting about the climate change. It was, when was it going to manifest at the worst if we did not keep the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere below 400, and we've already exceeded. In May, it went up to 415 parts per million.
Right. And if what happens, folks, is it means that water is retained in the atmosphere as the atmosphere gets warmer, and that's why these storms are so violent.
That's right. And the projection of the computer models in the early 90s was that if we didn't contain that CO2 level at 400 or lower, that the projected winds, the projected floods, the projected rain, snow, all of it, by 2030 could be killing people massively.
Well, so, and it will be. It's simple as that.
We're on track for that.
Yeah, and, you know, you're going to have what is, we don't think about this now, but it will be called mega deaths, where massive numbers of people die. And a lot of that's going to happen in places like India and central India and China. These places are completely without any kind of, they're lacking in water. They're lacking in infrastructure. And when the temperature goes much above 125 degrees, 127 degrees Fahrenheit, the human body becomes unable to survive. It becomes an unsurvivable heat level of heat because the body can't do heat exchange fast enough.
Yeah.
And there will be millions of people trapped in that. And then what do the people, I mean, I wonder, speaking of souls, what do the climate change deniers do with themselves? If they have caused this, and to a great extent, it is their fault.
Well, yeah, it's been turned into political battles as opposed to, again, cause and effect education by scientists that would have been able, hopefully, to show, demonstrate, and people can argue, well, it started with scientists and then it ended up with politicians, and that is always the wrong exchange.
That is, could not be more true. Linda, listen, we started out to talk for half an hour. We've now been talking for an hour, and I know the two of us could easily go on for hours more, but I think it's time to call a halt and say to be continued.
Yeah.
There's another thing that I'd like to touch on before we go, and that gets back to that lady who heard the voice, and it has to do with telepathy. I think it's something that the people behind this are really mortally afraid of. I mean, the people behind all of the attempts to control this. They fear that something breaks down at a certain point in the human mind, which is the filter that filters out other thoughts, and telepathy becomes possible. And once that is the case, then these people's game is up. They can't hide anymore.
If we start receiving the telepathic messages.
Telepathy is real. I have experienced it, folks. It is entirely real.
Yes.
So that is that. It is real. It is possible. Because we don't have the science to understand it doesn't mean it isn't there, because it is.
Yes.
Okay. let's both go and sit and have a cup of tea and try to calm down.
I know that I sometimes am emotional, but I also that audiences react to me as I am. I am a very honest person. I am honest, and it comes across. And I am deeply, deeply concerned that we are on a planet that is being lied to, manipulated, deflected to all of the crap.
Lied to, manipulated, and deflected into dying.
Others are planning to take advantage of being able to go to Mars and to other planets while whatever happens to Earth happens, and then someday they might come back. That just enrages me.
Me too. It's outrageous. It's absolutely outrageous. But there they are, and that's what's happening here.
Yeah.
But you know, by the way, folks, you mentioned, Linda mentioned a couple of times that this presentation takes 3 hours. And I thought to myself, both times I heard you say that, I cannot believe that it was 3 hours. It seemed like 15 minutes.
Yeah,
it was so
everybody
intense.
Has told me that, I am so grateful because I think the information is so important, that they could not believe. I had many people say, you actually talked for 3 hours, and I was totally
enthralled.
I was totally encompassed, enthralled in what you were saying. And I just go, yay, because we need for people on a larger scale to be exposed to this.
And, absolutely.
And so if I'm contributing, I am grateful. I am extremely concerned, and I apologize for being somewhat emotional, but it is based on my true compassionate concern for our species that we are yet still being abused.
Linda, thank you so much for being with us. I'm forcing myself to stop because I promised you half an hour. I took an hour, and I don't think you have all that much time. I know how busy you are.
Oh, well, same with you.
Yeah.
God bless everybody who is listening. Try to get your leaders politically to deal with this.
And I have to tell you another thing, folks. Get to one of Linda's speeches, especially the intensive. It is intense. There's no question about it.
All right.
Thank you,
Whitley.
Bye now.
Bye.
Next up for subscribers, I'm going to be reading From the Beginning of a New World. This is a book about how to communicate with the visitors. It is not a like an instruction manual. That's not what they want. It is a book about my experiences in communicating with them over the past 30 years, and especially since 2015, when a whole new world has opened up for me of understanding the rich, subtle, and powerful communications that are out there. It is a totally different way of communicating than we're used to. It has nothing to do with channeling, with talking, with the written word, with anything like that. It is a way of life, and it is absolutely amazing. So, subscribers, listen up to this next segment.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.